गुड इवनिंग फ्रेंड्स, आज डिस्कस करने वाले हैं फर्टिलिटी इवैल्यूएशन। फर्टिलिटी इवैल्यूएशन करने के लिए पूरे कॉन्सेप्ट्स है, टेक्निक्स लाइक प्लांट एनालिसिस, रिस, क्रॉप लॉगिंग, बायोलॉजिकल टेस्ट एंड माइक्रोबियल टेस्ट। फर्स्ट प्लांट एनालिसिस, वी विल बी डीलिंग विद प्लांट एनालिसिस। वी आर डूइंग प्लांट एनालिसिस ड्यू बिकॉज वी हैव टू इंडिकेट what is the particular nutrient is supplying by the soil and the quantity of nutrients present in the soil. ये दो टाइप के हैं, एक टिश्यू टेस्ट एंड अदर इज टोटल एनालिसिस इन द लैबोरेटरी। फर्स्ट टिश्यू टेस्ट, दिस इज अ रैपिड टेस्ट बिकॉज वी आर डायरेक्टली गोइंग टू द फील्ड एंड वी आर कंडक्टिंग द कलेक्टिंग प्लांट सैप एंड देन वी आर ट्रीटिंग द प्लांट सैप विद पर्टिकुलर रिएजेंट एंड द कलर डेवलप्ड इंटेंसिटी बेस्ड ऑन द इंटेंसिटी ऑफ द कलर वी विल मैच दैट कलर विद स्टैंडर्ड कर्व स्टैंडर्ड चार्ट्स एंड देन बेस्ड ऑन दैट वी विल identify that whether the nutrient is present, whether it is deficient or excessive. It is tested for unassimilated nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium. This type of test is semi-quantitative test for predict deficiency of N, P and K. In this, we are taking latest mature leaf for testing. And the time is at the time of bloom or from bloom to early fruiting stage in morning or late in afternoon. And it is low cost and it is simplicity. And other is total analysis. In this, we are determining all the elements which are associated with plant nutrients. Done in laboratory and the instruments which are used are atomic absorption spectrophotometers, spark emission spectrometers, inductive coupled plasma. By inductive coupled plasma, we will be able to determine about 22 elements. And the other is RIS, that is diagnosis and recommended integrated system. Diagnosis, we are first diagnosing. It is developed by Biofields in 1973. In other, we are determining only one element. Like in tissue test, we are determining N, P or K. In total analysis also, atomic absorption spectrometers, it may detect only phosphorus or micronutrients. Inductive coupled plasma, it is determining 22 elements, but they are determining separately. Whereas in RIS, It is a dual ratio concept. The nutrient ratios are considered in this rather than the single nutrient value. The leaf tissue, the amount of nutrient concentration ratios, we are comparing this with the norms which are obtained from a high yielding group. It considered the nutrient ratio in the plants for fertility recommendation. It is mostly suitable for long duration crops and it is tested for soybean and wheat. The main concept of this is we have to maintain the ratio between the NP, NK, N by K, P by K and calcium or magnesium. And also the second concept is we have to maintain the constant of the product of nitrogen and calcium. In the beginning stage, the nitrogen and phosphorus is more, but with just age increase hota hai plant ka, then calcium and boron will be more and the nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium decreases because it is mostly used in the early stage. So we have to maintain the constant of nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, the ratios. If we maintain the ratio, it is okay. If the ratio is different from the first one, then we have to recommend the fertilizer. It is mainly measuring the specific nutrients in the leaf or the plant from the optimum range. This graph indicates the relationship between yield and the nutrient concentration. These are the ranges, that is deficient range, marginal, adequate, and the excessive, that is toxic. In deficient range, at a particular time, it starts showing deficiency. Means, agar thoda kam hai, toh theek hai. Agar zyada deficiency hai, toh it starts showing deficiency. And if you are supplying it essential element, then it starts increasing the dry matter yield. Second is a marginal. In marginal, it lies critical range. Critical range mein do hota hai, ek below and above. Below, even if we add some essential element, it trigger in increase in the yield. Above critical range, even if you are adding so much, it won't increase the dry matter yield. It just remains stable. Just like in adequate, also the same. In adequate, the nutrient concentration is increasing, but the dry matter is remaining constant. In high, if you are increasing the nutrient concentration, but the dry matter is not increasing, to a particular level, it increases. It remains stable. But if you are increasing the nutrient concentration in the plant part, the dry matter is start decreasing and the yield will also decrease. And the next is crop logging. It is carried out for sugarcane in Hawaii. Crop logging is just like the progress report. It is maintaining the performance of the crop by taking, we are calculating here the chemical and physical measurements. In this, we are considering critical nutrient concentration approach. एक student जब college जाता है या school जाता है उसका progress report रहता है, मतलब वो क्या कैसे perform कर रहा है, जैसे first unit test, second unit test, quarterly, half yearly. So this is that is for student, and this crop logging is for a crop. In this, we are maintaining the record by analyzing nitrogen. See, I said that it is a, it contains a series of chemical and physical measurements, like in chemical analyzing nitrogen, sugar, whereas physical measurements are moisture and weight of the tissue. At a critical stage, we are measuring phosphorus and potassium based on the moisture. Moisture le liya, uske baad usme moisture kam hai, then we will be irrigating the crop by taking analyzing nitrogen, sugar, weight. Then we will think that nitrogen, there may be nitrogen deficient, then we will be adding the fertilizer. This is all about crop logging. And next is soil test crop response. We are calculating soil testing. We are in crop response because in order to sustain the yield and to reduce the cost of fertilizer dose and in turn cost of cultivation, we have to follow this approach. This approach is established by ICR on AICRP on STCR is established in 1967. It was developed by Ramamurthy in 1987. It produces the relationship soil test or crop response. Jaise we can compare it with a patient. If patient goes to hospital, first doctor क्या करता है, ब्लड टेस्ट लेता है, उसके बाद वो क्या करता है, रिकमेंड करता है ये दवाई खाना, ये मेडिसिन लिया है तो कम हो जा सकता है. सेम लाइक दैट in this we are calculating the, we are determining the soil nutrient levels of the soil by soil test, and then based on that we are comparing that with recommended dose. Agar ek plant ka recommended dose of fertilizer 20 nitrogen hai, and soil test mein soil can supply only 10 kg of nitrogen, then deficient kitna hai, 10 hai. So we have to supply the 10 kg of nitrogen externally. This is also called as rationalized fertilizer prescription approach. In this, we are considering the inert soil fertility. मतलब soil fertility कितना capacity, how much it can produce, it can provide to the crops, and the recommended dose. And different regions have different fertilizer recommended doses. And the indicator plans which are used for soil fertility evaluations are all these. If a crop is grown in a particular soil, if it is deficient, it starts showing deficient symptoms immediately. Like agar cabbage, egg, cauliflower, tomato, brinjal grow kar rahe. If the soil is deficient in nitrogen and calcium, then the immediate deficiency is seen on cabbage and cauliflower, but not in tomato, brinjal. Same like that, phosphorus, we use rapeseed. For potassium, magnesium, potato, iron, cauliflower, cabbage, oats, and potato. For zinc, maize, and sodium, boron, sugar beet. For manganese, sugar beet, oats, and potato. Molybdenum, lucerne, and copper, wheat. Next, this is the deficiency test of sunflower for boron. In this, we are taking sunflower for testing boron. It is grown in first test. Sunflower is grown in the test soil, and we are supplying all the nutrition solution except boron. And from, we started observing it from the day, if it starts showing deficient symptoms on the leaves on 28th day, then we can consider it as the soil is deficient. If it is not showing deficient symptoms even after 28 days, like till 28 to 36 days, it is okay. After it started showing deficiency symptom, then we will consider it as moderately deficient. If it is not at all showing deficiency even after 36 days, then we can say that soil is perfectly available. It has the availability of boron in it and is not deficient. Next, microbial method. Same like plants, microorganisms also has the capacity to respond differently for the different nutrients present in it. It was observed by Vinogradsky. Microorganisms are the sensitive to deficiency of nutrients and can be used to detect the deficiency of any nutrient. Like in this, we will be taking soil and we are incubating the soil with the different microbes. Then it started its development, growth and development. If it develops large number of mycelia pad, then we can say it is not deficient. The soil is not deficient. Just example, एजिटोबैक्टर, और आप सॉइल लिया है उसमें अगर फोर यू टेक फोर पेट्री डिश एंड यू ऐड इन वन यू ऐड इन फोर यू ऐड एजिटोबैक्टर. इफ वन इज चेक इट इज विदाउट ऑल द न्यूट्रिएंट्स then it starts growing very less and other petri dish will be grown soon. The mycelia in the petri dish will grow to large amount. So we can say that azotobacter method for calcium, phosphorus and potassium. Aspergillus niger test for phosphorus and potassium. And Metrigan cullinghamella, it is a fungus. It is a plaque test for phosphorus. Whereas Sackett and Stever techniques are used to find out the phosphorus and potassium test status in the soil. Mulder, Aspergillus niger test for copper, magnesium, molybdenum, cobalt, sulfur, and zinc. Next, manures. Manures are the organic materials which are derived from animals, human, and plant residues. These contain the plant nutrients in complex organic form. Complex organic form मतलब क्या है? Fertilizers, if you add only urea, it is supplying only nitrogen. It is not supplying all the nutrients and it is not supplying micronutrients or nothing. But whereas manure, if you supply manure, 1 kg manure, it has all the essential elements like NPK, micronutrients, सब कुछ उसमें है. इसलिए ये complex organic form है manures. The major sources of the manures are farm wastes, cattle shed waste, human habitation waste, slaughterhouse waste, fish meal, and the byproducts of agro industries. Next classification is, it is of two types. There is bulky organic manure and concentrated organic manure. Bulky मतलब ज़्यादा डाल देना. क्यों ज़्यादा डाल दे? क्योंकि उसमें micronutrients बहुत micronutrients ही नहीं elements बहुत कम है. The nutrient presence in the bulky organic manure is very less. That's why we have to add so much amount of. For 1 kg of nitrogen, we have to add some extra tons. But whereas in concentrated organic manure, we have to add very less because it has highest amount of nutrient in it. Bulky organic manures के example, FIM, compost, sewage and slut. FIM, cattle manure and sheep manure and poultry manure. In compost means village or rural compost and town compost. Whereas concentrated organic manure, oil cakes, it has low CN ratio. Low CN ratio matlab, it has a capacity to release large amount of nitrogen in short time. It is of two types, that is edible and non-edible oil cakes. Edible is used for cattle feeding. Non-edible used as manures. Examples, mustard cake, linseed cake, groundnut cake and sesamum cake. Non-edible oil cakes, castor, neem, mahua, sugar, sunflower and
excuse me ma'am. Huh? Ma'am, can you tell me about CN ratio?
CN ratio?
Yes ma'am.
Like, if CN ratio is low, it means the nitrogen can be released very fastly in shorter time. I mean, it has low carbon and high nitrogen levels.
Okay ma'am, okay.
Slaughterhouse waste like blood meal and bone meal. And third is fish meal. And guano, these are the materials obtained from the excreta and dead bodies of the seabird. It is rich in nitrogen and phosphorus. Green manure, two types. That is legume. Okay, I will be discussing about green manure later. FIM, it is a decomposed mixture of dung and urine of farm animals along with the litter and leftover material from roughness or fodder fed to the cattle. The NPK content in FIM is 0.5% nitrogen, 0.2% phosphorus and 0.5% potassium. Whereas urine contains about 1.35% potassium. During storage, most of the nutrients get leached and volatilized. To prevent that volatilization and leaching losses, we have to adopt some methods. They are pit method, trench method mostly. Hip method losses will be more. In pit method, it is most commercially adopted by farmers. In this, pits are made about 8 meters length, 2 meters width and 1 meter depth. In this, pits are filled in layer by the mixture of dung, urine and litter up to 50 centimeters above the ground level. Then the pit is plastered by the mud paste. One pit needed 2 adult animals. Like it become ready in 180 days, 6 months is needed and obtained in, okay, one pit can give about 10 to 12 tons of FIM. Every animal gives 5 to 6 tons of FIM per year. It is about pit method. In trench method, it is also called as Acharya method. In this, trenches are made of about 68 meter length and 2 meter width and 1.1 to 1.25 meter width depth. And then mixture of dung and urine soaked litter is deposited in the layers above 50 centimeter above the ground. Then it is covered with 50 centimeter deep soil or wood ash, and then it is plastered with mud paste. It is also get ready in 150 to 160 days. Then heap method. This is most commonly used by the farmers. Okay, when we enter any village, we can see some heaps of dung on the sides in a free, just a free space है वहाँ पे तो वो लोग लाके डाल देते हैं, ये heap method है वो. Dung है, इसमें क्या करते हैं, जो dung है litter simply collect करके उसमें एक place में deposit कर देते. This is stored in 6 to 9 months. By this method, leaching, washing and volatilization losses are so much. Because they are not covering that heap method. They are not covering those heaps. So most, due to rainfall, it gets leached and washed. And due to the sunlight and all that, it gets volatilized. The loss of nutrients in this is about 30 to 35% nitrogen, 20-25% phosphorus and 4 to 6% potassium. It should be applied before sowing, about 20 days before. And the rate of application is 20 ton per hectare for most of the crops. Next is compost.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yeah.
Which among these three methods is the best method for this preparation?
For this preparation, trench method will be good.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay. As heap method, there are a lot of losses. And pit method is also good, but trench method is more advanced than pit method. And compost, it is the process of decomposing organic waste. So what is the difference between FIM and compost? FIM means it is simply we are collecting dung, urine and litter, leftover litter and fodder fed to the cattle. But whereas in compost, we are collecting urban wastes, kitchen wastes, any vegetable, all that we are collecting and we are decomposing it in a particular pit. It is compost. The types are Bangalore method, Coimbatore and Indore method. These are the methods adopted to make compost. One is Bangalore method. It was developed by Acharya. In this, aerobic and anaerobic decomposition takes place. How first we are filling the pit with dry layer of wastes. And then the cow dung suspension we are spraying on it. After that, we are making these pit about 0.5 meter above ground level. For the first 15 days, we are leaving it exposed. So aerobic decomposition is going on. After that, we are covering it with wet mud and we are keeping it. So anaerobic decomposition is going on after that, after 15 days. So partially aerobic, after that anaerobic decomposition is going on. It should be left undisturbed for 5 months. It will get ready in 6 to 8 months. And the percentage recovery is more in Bangalore method. It contains 1.5% nitrogen, 1% phosphorus, and 1.5% potassium. In Indore method, the organic wastes are spread in the cattle shed. These organic wastes will act as a bedding method. And then the wastes are removed after some days from the shed and they are deposited in a pit. And about 15 centimeter layer is to be made. After the urine soaked earth material is to be mixed in water. And then it has to be sprinkled over the waste twice or thrice a day. Then it continues for about a fortnight, means 15 days. And then after that, we have to bring some decomposed compost. This decomposed compost acts as an inoculum, and this we have to spread on as a thin layer on the top. Then we have to leave it undisturbed for a month. It gets ready in another month. In Coimbatore, a layer of waste material is laid in the pit. It is to be moistened with the suspension of 10 kg cow dung in 5 liters of water. And then we are adding 1 kg fine bone meal and we are sprinkling it uniformly. It is to be made about 0.7 meter above the ground level. Then it has to be plastered with wet mud and left undisturbed for 10 weeks. And moisted whenever required and give a small turning. Next, green manure. Green manure is a green undecomposed plant material. We are using it as manure. It is obtained by two ways. One is we are growing green manure crops along with the crops. And second is we are bringing twigs from outside, from the burns or from other plants, trees, and then we are incorporating it in the soil. In this, Sesbania rostrata is a stem nodulating green manure crop. This Sesbania rostrata has the nodulation site on the stem, and the TSR1 is a mutant variety of Sesbania rostrata. It is insensitive to photoperiod. It can tolerate salinity and waterlogging conditions. Glyphosate is the most effective and used in sodic soils. Green manure has a capacity to reclaim alkali soils also. And root knot nematode can also be controlled by green manure. Where is brown manure? It was first initiated in Lockhart district of North South Wales, Australia in 1996. Difference between green manure and brown manure. Green manure, we are incorporating green undecomposed plant material in the soil. Whereas brown manure, we are first we are planting the brown manure crops with cereal crops. And after that, we are spraying herbicide on it, post-emergence herbicide. After that, it becomes brown color. So we will leave it and allow it to decompose it by itself. And then it will get decomposed itself and then it acts as mulch. This is brown manure. As the color of the manure is changing due to the spray of herbicide, it is losing the chlorosis content in it. So chlorophyll content is getting lost. So chlorosis is taking place and it is turning brown color. That's why it is known as brown manure. This is the concept of brown manure.
In the previous slide, TSR1 is what?
Mutant variety of Sesbania rostrata.
Of Sesbania?
Yeah.
Okay. And ma'am, in brown manuring, the crops include our example?
Example, it is here. Sesbania, okay. Crotalaria, okay. And poppy. Okay. Brown manuring, we without tillage, we will be growing brown manure crops. And then we are spraying herbicide on the brown manure crops. That is 2,4-D. After that, it loses its chlorophyll content and then it turns brown color. Then it is acting as mulching. And the crops for brown manuring are Sesbania, Crotalaria, and Cowpea. Next is sheep and goat manure. This manure contains about 3% nitrogen, 1% phosphorus, and 2% potassium. 3-1-2. It is applied in two ways. One is directly we are collecting the sheep and we are sheep manures and we are putting it in steep pits and letting it to decompose and we are applying it later to the field. And second, sheep penning. And sheep penning is an important part of organic farming. In this process, the sheep are made to stay in the field overnight, which enables the fecal matter and urine are left in the field. Later, it is incorporated to the shallow depth by working blade harrow or cultivator. Sheep penning, जैसे एक फार्मर को शीप पेनिंग करना है उसको एक फार्मर को मेन्यू चाहिए एंड ये शेपर्ड्स वांट्स मनी दिस इज अ म्यूचुअल प्रोसेस एक्चुअली इफ अ शेपर्ड कैन टेक ऑल द शीप्स टू हिज फील्ड एंड लेट इट स्टे इट ओवरनाइट देन ही दैट फार्मर विल गेट द मेन्यू एंड द शेपर्ड विल गेट द मनी फॉर द शीप्स लाइक वन शीप इफ ही टेक्स 10 शीप for one sheep, if we collect 20 rupees, then he will get 200 rupees. So soil is getting fertile by sheep manures, and the farmer is getting the manure, and the shepherd is getting the 200 rupees. So in this, all are getting benefited. Next is poultry manure. The extract of birds ferment quickly. It contains 3% nitrogen, 2.6% phosphorus, and 1.4% of potassium. In bone meal, the sources of bone meal are slaughterhouse, meat processing and dead animals, as they are rich in phosphorus and calcium. It is slow acting and ideal for alkali soils and also for long duration crops. And other is vermicomposting. Vermicompost is a process which is based on earthworms and microorganisms. These earthworms, they conduct the joint actions and it provide the degradation, detoxification of organic wastes. And they convert these organic wastes into the useful agronomic product, which is useful for our agronomic purposes. The NPK content of it is 1.2 to 1.6% nitrogen, 1.8% phosphorus, and 5 to 0.575% potassium. The rate of application is, as a basal application we can do it 3 ton per hectare, and the top dressing 1.5 ton per hectare, and fruit for fruit plant, for one tree we are adding about 1 to 10 kg depending upon the age of the fruit plant. And for vegetables, 10 ton per hectare. And others, fertilizer. Fertilizers are synthetic, commercially manufactured or naturally occurring chemical compounds. They are either rice solid or liquid that are added to soil to supply one or more plant nutrition for plant growth. the classification, they are classified based upon the amount of nutrients present in it and the chemical nature or the commercial mode of supply, like as straight or compound or complex or mixed. State fertilizer, it has a capacity to supply only one primary nutrients. It is like urea is supplying only nitrogen. Ammonium sulfate is supplying ammonia, nitrogen and sulfur, but only one primary nutrient, that is nitrogen. We all know that primary nutrients are NPK. So it has to supply only one primary nutrients. Like KCl is supplying only potassium and it is supplying chlorine. But we are not considering chlorine. We have to consider only one primary nutrient, that is potassium in it. And complex fertilizer, it is supplying two or more primary nutrients, but they are in chemically bond, chemical combination. Example, DAP. They are chemically bond during manufacturing itself. And ammonium phosphate, ammonia nitrogen, phosphate, phosphorus, but they are chemically bonded. In mixed fertilizer, there are two or more primary fertilizers, but we are mixing it mechanically or manually. Like nitrogen and SSP, urea and SSP, we can mix it manually. So they are the mixed fertilizers. And next, based on the concentration of primary plant nutrients, they are divided into low analysis and high analysis.
Excuse me, ma'am, what is the difference between mixed and complex?
Mixed and complex.
Yes,
complex
ma'am.
Chemically combined. We are mixing physically. Like we are mixing urea and DAP, if we, urea and SSP, if we are mixing it separately. We are not, whereas complex, they are formed in chemical itself, like while manufacturing. Based on concentration of primary plant nutrients, there are low analysis and high analysis. It contains less than 25% of primary plant nutrients, example SSP and sodium nitrate. Whereas high analysis, it supplies more than 25% of primary plant nutrients, example urea and DAP. In this urea, it's supplying 46% nitrogen, whereas DAP is supplying 18% nitrogen, but 46% phosphorus. So 46, more than 25% is supplying. So it is known as high analysis. Based on physical form, they are solid and liquid. Solid, they are mostly in solid form. Example, powder, that is SSP. Crystal like ammonium sulfate, prills, urea, DAP and SSP are present in prill form. Granules like halide granules, super granules, urea super granules, and briquettes, urea briquettes. Liquid suspension, it is mostly used with, can be applied with irrigation water or for direct application can also be done with this. It is of two types, like clear liquid fertilizer is there and suspension liquid. Clear liquid, even after mixing, it is completely getting dissolved in the water. So it is forming clear liquid. With the suspension, the fine particles are present in the water. So this is a suspension liquid fertilizer. First is SSP, powder, urea, ammonium sulfate and SSP in prill form. That is first is powder form and SSP prill form. And other classification of nitrogen fertilizer is classified into four groups. One is nitrate, ammonium, nitrate and ammonium fertilizer. Next, amide. Nitrate, these are the examples. Sodium nitrate, calcium nitrate, potassium nitrate. Whereas ammonium, ammonium sulfate, ammonium phosphate, ammonium chloride and anhydrous ammonia. Nitrate and ammonium fertilizers, ammonium nitrate, calcium ammonium nitrate and ammonium sulfate nitrate. Amide fertilizers, urea and calcium cyanamide. The nitrogen content in fertilizers, ammonium sulfate has 20.6%, whereas ammonium chloride 25-26%, urea 46%, calcium cyanamide 21%, anhydrous ammonia 82%, sodium nitrate 16%, calcium nitrate 15%, ammonium sulfate nitrate has 26% nitrate. Any doubts?
मैम जैसे कि इतनी सारी ये फर्टिलाइजर्स हैं इनकी परसेंटेज कैसे रिमेम्बर करें हाँ जी
अभी मैट्रिक लाऊंगी नेक्स्ट क्लास में ठीक है चलेगा
ओके मैम चलेगा
और कुछ
थैंक यू सो मच मैम
ओके दूसरे क्लास में मैं फर्स्ट और सेकंड क्लास के जो है ना उसका रिवीजन करवाऊंगी और थोड़ा ऑब्जेक्टिव्स पे बताने वाली हूँ
ओके मैम
अगर एग्जाम पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से जो इम्पोर्टेंट इम्पोर्टेंट है वो भी मैं बनाने वाली हूँ, उसके बाद अपन नेक्स्ट टॉपिक पे जाएंगे। और अगर आपको नाइट्रोजन मैन्युफैक्चरिंग भी, नाइट्रेट फर्टिलाइजर के मैन्युफैक्चरिंग प्रोसेस भी चाहिए हो तो मैं वो भी एक्सप्लेन करूँगी वो दूसरे क्लास में। अगर उतना डीप नहीं जाना है तो ठीक है, अगर डीप में जैसे अभी एग्रोकेमिकल्स भी ऐड हुआ है आपके सिलेबस में, सो आई विल डील विद इट ऑल्सो इफ यू वॉन्ट।
Yes, ma'am. Sure, ma'am.
Okay. Next class, I will be teaching about, I will be taking revision and I will provide some important points also. Okay. Okay, then take care. Bye-bye.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.